Hi, welcome to Report from the State Legislature. I'm Senator Bill Stachowski. Today my guest is Keith Hyde. He's an economic development analyst for Senate Finance, and we thought we would talk a little bit about the budget and economic development, and it's probably more one of the more comforting things to talk about, particularly in this year's budget, where there's so much doom and gloom. Economic development seems to be one area where there's some bright spots, and in particular there's some money, because everyone knows if you don't continue to develop the economy, there's no chance of getting out of the downturn.
Oh, Senator, thank you for bringing me on board. Yes, actually we've identified three primary issues in the executive's budget proposal. The first would be the proposed consolidation of the state's economic development entities. That would include the Department of Economic Development and the Foundation for Science, Technology, and Innovation, which would be consolidated into the Empire State Development Corporation. The second primary issue would be the Empire's own reform proposals, and the third would be the executive proposal to take a look at the over $6.8 billion in reappropriated capital and to repurpose approximately $375
million. Well, so if there's let's start with the first area, the combining of the three different areas. There's some concern, I know, already among legislators, because they're saying that, okay, we like economic development, but the problem we have is if we combine them in the fashion as the governor presented in his budget, one, the two that are folding into the one larger one have lower paying positions that, if you're going to save money, you would maybe be looking to take some of the highest paying positions out and have some impact. And then the second part of that is the other two have a lot of regulation and oversight, and there's not a lot of regulation and oversight in what would be the last player standing. So maybe you'd like to talk about those two areas. Start with the regulation and oversight.
Okay, Senator. The regulation and oversight, as you know, Empire State Development Corporation is a public benefit corporation. They are not regulated by the state. They are not part of state government. In comparison, the Department of Economic Development has regulation and oversight over the economic development programs that they administer. If these programs were to be consolidated into the ESD, I think it's unprecedented that a state agency would be consolidated into a public benefit corporation. And on February 3rd, when we have the joint legislative hearings, that's one of the primary questions that we're going to be asking the corporation.
Yeah, and it's important for us, and even NYSTAR has, I think, some oversight in its operation also. And so that's of some concern to us, because the only recourse we have is when things are regulated, and when it's a public benefit corporation and outside of state purview, the legislature has very little input and oversight on what goes on. And not that we don't plan to work with closely all the people in that department, as well as the governor and his people. It's not the nature normally of the legislature to just be entirely trusting and hope for goodwill and make sure everything's going to come out the way you put it in the budget and hope it comes out.
Yes, Senator, that would be a primary concern, in the fact that these two entities would now be out of the legislature's jurisdiction and would be primarily a subsidiary of the executive.
Yeah, so I think there's a possible solution for all this, and I'm sure we'll be looking how to handle this, where that we ensure that we'll still have some oversight as a state legislative body over what goes on, and not just make it entirely the realm of the public benefit corp. And we really are delighted with the new director. We think that she's very capable. We think she shows tremendous grasp already. She seems to be very willing to work with everybody at her confirmation hearings, both at the committee level and at the finance hearing. She answered everybody's questions in detail, seems to have a very good grasp so far, and it was saying that she would be continuing to get a handle on everything, and actually even talked about how closely she works with the upstate person that we just also joined us, Mr. Mullen, and he too brings a lot to the table, and as he was a business person from Rochester, and has been traveling all over the state, and had the opportunity to work with him also, and he looks to be very promising, and things are looking good from that point. But I think there still will be some concern, and I'm sure that we'll work it out before the budget passes.
Absolutely, Senator. As you know, the ESD Corporation has reconfigured once again. In the 2007 budget, it was proposed to create an upstate and a downstate chairman. That has been reconfigured to include just one chairman who happens to be from Buffalo, correct?
No, she's actually a New York City
person. About Robert Wilmers.
Oh, yes, Mr. Wilmers is Buffalo, yes.
From Buffalo, and I think that can only benefit the upstate region.
Yeah, the director that is from New York City, that is going to be the day-to-day hands-on person. However, she understands the tremendous interest in upstate, the tremendous concern that before we did the dual leadership, that we had a situation in the state where things were agreed upon locally, sent to New York City, and sometimes never to be heard from again. And so the concern was that very situation repeating itself, but we have all kinds of assurances, and I have no reason not to believe her. I think she's a wonderful lady. And I think that with the combination of Mr. Mullen and actually having the Mr. Wilmers involved, I think will benefit greatly all of upstate. And hopefully that'll be used as a tool to get the upstate economic engine going.
Right, Senator. If you recall, in the 08-09 enacted budget, there was the Upstate Revitalization Fund, which was originally proposed at $1 billion. Due to economic circumstances, it was cut to $700 million. And none of that money went out the door. And for whatever reason, whether it be political, economics, whatever the cause. If you recall from the executive State of the State address, he actually called on the corporation to begin to administer that program. So that should definitely benefit the region.
Yeah, and he talked about administering it in the same fashion as was designed, with agricultural input, venture capital situation, transportation input, and even some revitalization of the state parks, for example, that will encourage the tourism industry.
Absolutely.
And enhance it. So that was very good news in the governor's budget in that respect, and we're looking forward to working with Mr. Mullen on that. And then we get to the stimulus part that we don't know what's coming, but we do know that shovel-ready projects are going to qualify for stimulus, and it's going to be in a wide range, but also a lot of it seems to be headed towards infrastructure, so that if people are prepared with road projects, bridge projects, that'll be a tremendous enhancement to the budget, but also a tremendous enhancement to the possibilities for upstate economy.
Absolutely, and I think that until that stimulus package is known, I think that possibly budget negotiations would be slightly delayed until we know exactly how much money will be coming our way.
Well, we're hoping that in that case the president gets his way and gets that stimulus package out very, very quickly. And now they're talking about having some parts of that for education, which would also help in a part of the budget that is under duress. And the other interesting thing about the building stimulus piece is that if the universities have shovel-ready projects that can be used for that also, and the universities have been pushing on some construction and in some cases reconstruction of aging campuses that will be very, very helpful. And as we know, in upstate, the universities play a tremendous role in the economic development package.
Absolutely, and I think that's one cause for concern in terms of the proposed consolidation, and that NYSTAR is a big part of what administers what money goes to those higher education universities. And it's a entity that works, and it leverages private and federal money for these programs, and it's a great collaboration of federal, private, and state money to create these educational and technologically based jobs and opportunities.
And in our area, the largest, most unifiedly backed project is UB 2020, which everybody thinks will have a dynamic impact on Buffalo's economy. It'll make the university bigger, more involved in the community, and also using its intellectual capital to spin off and help the economic growth. So for us, it's a win-win having the stimulus available for projects like that.
Absolutely, and the UB 2020, we should also point out, too, that the Senate Democrats had a economic development proposal in December of 2007. Unfortunately, we weren't able to do anything with it due to political circumstances. However, you'll see that we proposed a substantial amount of money for several projects that would be aligned with what the UB 2020 proposes, including infrastructure, higher education, agriculture, et cetera.
And part of the proposal was to bring a lot of the universities to have more of a presence in upstate cities, and it's a natural connection. And I know that also in the UB 2020 case that they are also tied to the biomedical center, which one of the major projects is this new vascular center that is going to be all-inclusive, one building with everything that's possible to be done in vascular areas, from strokes to surgeries to heart situations, and also floors dedicated strictly to research. And it's never been done before in one facility, so that'll be a major step for Buffalo.
Absolutely. The one thing that I have questions about, Senator, and I want to talk to you about is the Empire Zone reforms. In terms of one of the proposals would do away with the configuration of the current zones, in that it would take away from the original intent, in that the zones were meant to be designated in particular areas of economic blight, if you would. And what this proposal will do now is it would do away with those boundaries, in that these economic development benefits, Empire Zone benefits, would be available to any project in any location. And I think that a lot of what the Empire Zones do are beneficial, particularly in upstate. But I think that this has the potential to be abused and to even drive the program further away from its original intentions.
Well, I think we have a close eye on that. There's a lot of members that are very, very focused on the Empire Zones. There is a tremendous focus on trying to recapture the original intent of the Empire Zones. There's a tremendous push to get better transparency and to make sure that the benefits available and what comes out of them aren't abused. And so that I think that we will have a package that will work. I think that we'll come up with a package that's workable. I think also everybody will recognize that there will be regionally significant projects, and those are currently available where they take the benefits from one of the Empire Zones and maybe locate them in an area that's not in the Empire Zone, but there's benefits back to the people from the Empire Zone. And so that those things will still be available, and we should be able to stem some of the areas that maybe don't need Empire Zone benefits to get people to locate there.
Right, and that significant regional project would be the exception and not the rule.
Exactly.
As the current proposal would, it would make it the rule.
And we're going to be looking closely at that too, obviously, and the governor has $20 to one state dollar, and people will be looking at that and seeing how workable that is. And we're running out of time, but we will mention that if we come back, we'll start out with the IDA reform too, which is another thing that's been kind of just hanging and limping along listlessly, with both sides, everybody involved, wanting something done but not being able to get there. And we're hoping to get everybody to the table and try to get somewhere in that area too.
Absolutely, Senator. That seems to be the solution. There's three different proposals out there, but there's no reason why we all can't come together.
And nobody thought workers' comp would ever be reformed, and they found a way to do it by bringing all the interested parties to the table. We're going to try to do the same thing with IDA reform. Keith, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Senator.
And thank you for joining us on State Senate Reports.